This is a homily for the fifth Sunday of Easter. The Gospel for this Sunday comes from the Gospel of St. John, chapter 14, verses 1 to 12. In his book, A Brief History of Time, the late Stephen Hawking makes an observation and then poses some questions. He writes, "We find ourselves in a bewildering world. We want to make sense of what we see around us and to ask, what is the nature of the universe? What is our place in it? And where did it and we come from? Why is it the way it is?" By way of response to those sort of questions, the French philosopher Gabriel Marcel made a useful distinction between problem and mystery. Firstly, what does he mean by problem? Marcel says this, "Whenever a problem is found, I am working upon data placed before me." What Marcel calls problems can be subjected to empirical verification and scientific testing. Consider these examples. A mechanic repairing an engine. A computer programmer tracking down an error in the system. A student struggling with a mathematical problem. A scientist seeking an antidote for a virus. A person challenged by a crossword puzzle. Someone absorbed in a whodunit. In all of those cases, time and experience will eventually yield an answer. A problem may totally absorb us, at least for a while, but we are capable of divorcing ourselves from it and getting on with something else. Mystery, however, describes those problems that engage us at a more profound level of our being. A mystery is a problem that encroaches upon and invades its own data. Mystery involves those questions in which we ourselves are immersed, questions that we cannot put to one side. We are actors, not detached spectators in the theatre of mystery. So, for example, I may ask, does my life have any ultimate meaning? Does God exist? Is there life after death? Why is there suffering and evil? How do I decide what's right and what's wrong? We respond to questions such as these by adopting a worldview, a story, a decoder, or a meta-narrative, something that will help us understand why things are the way they are. In other words, the lens through which our brain analyzes everything, or the self-narrative that we use to make sense of the world around us. One way of putting this is that we adopt a religion. Religion in the very broad sense of the word. Etymologically, our English word religion comes from the Latin religare, which means to tie back. So, for example, when we plant a sapling, we want it to grow tall and straight, so we tie it back to a stake in the ground. By way of analogy, the stake to which we bind the sapling is our worldview, our story, decoder, or meta-narrative. One of the basic premises of Jordan Peterson's book, Maps of Meaning, is that we view the world through a narrative lens. In 1978, Scott Peck wrote what was a bestseller, The Road Less Travelled. Writing before the advent of satellite navigation systems and smartphones, he uses the analogy of the map. But what he says of the map is equally true of other navigational systems. He writes, "Our view of reality is like a map with which to negotiate the terrain of life. If the map is true and accurate, we will generally know where we are, and if we have decided where we want to go, we will generally know how to get there. If the map is false and inaccurate, we generally will be lost." Some time ago, I drove to Brisbane, but the satellite navigation program in my car got me hopelessly lost because it couldn't recognize a newly constructed tunnel and freeway. So some maps and satellite navigation systems can get us lost. Likewise, not every worldview is equally liberating and life-giving. In A Brief History of Time, Stephen Hawking tells the story of a well-known scientist who gave a public lecture on astronomy. He explained how the Earth orbits around the Sun and how the Sun, in turn, orbits around the center of a vast collection of stars called our galaxy. At the end of the lecture, the scientist was challenged by a very confident and forthright lady. "What you have told us is rubbish. The world is really a flat plate supported on the back of a giant turtle." The scientist couldn't believe what he was hearing and did all he could to suppress a laugh. "If that is so, what is the turtle standing on?" Not to be deterred, the woman replied, "You're very clever, young man, very clever. But let me tell you, it's turtles all the way down." In telling this story, I want to make the simple point that there is no shortage of bogus worldviews. Hawking's story was about a bogus worldview of the physical universe, a flat plate supported on an infinite column of turtles. But certain ideologies are also bogus worldviews, and over time they eventually self-destruct. Consider the collapse of Soviet communism and Nazi Germany. Another bogus worldview is relativism. Pope Benedict had this to say, "We are moving toward a dictatorship of relativism, which does not recognize anything for certain, and which has as its highest goal one's own ego and one's own desires." But of course, there is an inherent contradiction in relativism. "There are no absolute truths." Is that absolutely true? Absolutely. And that response, of course, makes very clear the incoherent claims of relativism. Despite its logical incoherence, relativism runs rampant. Our culture is obsessed with freedom of choice. Whatever works for you. Truth is, whatever I want it to be. The technical name for this is voluntarism. Voluntarism is the view that things are true because I want them to be true. I came across this interesting illustration of voluntarism on YouTube. Some time ago, Joseph Backholm from the Family Policy Institute of Washington visited the campus of the University of Washington and interviewed several students. He asked one student, "If I told you I was a woman, what would your response be?" "Good for you. Okay. I don't have a problem with it." "If I told you I was Chinese, what would your response be?" "I'd be a little surprised, but I'd say good for you. Be who you are." "If I told you I was 6 feet 5 inches, what would you say?" The interviewer, by the way, is 5 feet 9 inches high. "It's not my place to say another human being is wrong, to draw lines or boundaries." "So, I can be a Chinese woman?" "Sure. But can I be a 6 feet, 5 inch Chinese woman? At this point, some students interviewed were indecisive, but most agreed that they would be fine with that description if that's what he truly felt he was. In their minds, evidently, gender, race, and even height were not objective states of reality, but a function of subjective desire. If you explained why you felt you were 6 feet five, I'd be very open to saying you were 6 feet 5 inches, or Chinese, or a woman. Subjective desire is quite understandable in many areas of life. So, for example, you may enjoy a certain kind of drink, and I can't stand it. I can't argue that my taste buds are right and that yours are wrong. We simply have different tastes. As the old saying goes, de gustibus non est disputandum. In matters of taste, there can be no disputes. But is all truth subjective? Are all beliefs simply a matter of taste? Is religion a matter of taste? Is one religion as good as another? Are all religions really saying much the same thing? This brings us to the heart of today's gospel. John's gospel devotes 5 out of 21 chapters to what Jesus did and said at the Last Supper. That's approximately one quarter of the gospel. Today's gospel, from Jesus' farewell discourse to his disciples, contains one of the most significant statements of Jesus in the gospel. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. Philip then asked Jesus, Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us. And Jesus replies, Have I been with you so long, Philip, and you still do not know me? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. In these few verses of chapter 14, we have reached the high point of Johannine theology. In her commentary on John's Gospel, New Testament scholar Gail O'Day highlights the importance of what Jesus has just said. This is the heart of the good news for the fourth evangelist, that in Jesus, the incarnate Word, the Son of God, one can see and know God in a manner never before possible. She goes on to say that these words affirm that Jesus is the tangible presence of God in the world, and that God the Father can be known only through that incarnate presence. Humanity's encounter with Jesus the Son makes possible a new experience of God as the Father. So here we have the Christian worldview. Jesus is the unique saving revelation of God. God is revealed in the life and word of Jesus. And Jesus is the only way to the Father. This is a radical claim, as New Testament scholar Tom Wright points out. Within the Western world of the last 2 centuries or so, this saying of Jesus has become one of the most controversial. I am the way and the truth and the life. How dare he? People have asked. Isn't this the height of arrogance to imagine that Jesus or anyone else was the only way? I know people, professing Christians, for whom it seems that their central article of faith is their rejection of this idea of Jesus' uniqueness. The trouble with this is that it doesn't work. If you dethrone Jesus, you enthrone something or someone else instead. The belief that all religions are really the same sounds nice and democratic, though the study of religions quickly shows that it isn't true. What you are really saying, if you claim that they're all the same, is that none of them are more than distant echoes, distorted images of reality. You're saying that reality, God, the divine, is remote and unknowable, and that neither Jesus, nor Buddha, nor Moses, nor Krishna gives us access to it. They all provide a way towards the foothills of the mountain, but not the way to the summit. It isn't just John's Gospel that you lose if you embrace this idea. The whole New Testament, the whole of early Christianity, insists that the one true and living God, the Creator, is the God of Israel, and that the God of Israel has acted decisively within history to bring Israel's story to its proper goal, and through that, to address and rescue the world. And the world needs rescuing. Such is the diagnosis of the human condition that we find in sacred scripture. In the words of theologian Fleming Rutledge, "From beginning to end, the Holy Scriptures testify that the predicament of fallen humanity is so serious, so grave, so irremediable from within, that nothing short of divine intervention can rectify it." In other words, we need a Saviour, and that is precisely what the name Jesus means. The Hebrew pronunciation of his name is Yeshua, which means God saves. He is our Saviour. And what do we mean by salvation? New Testament scholar Luke Timothy Johnson puts it this way: if salvation were simply a matter of correcting some mistaken ideas that humans held, then Jesus need be no more than a good teacher sent by God in the manner of Moses. If salvation were simply a question of rectifying social structures that were oppressing the people, then Jesus need be no more than a faithful prophet sent by God in the manner of Amos or Isaiah. If salvation, in short, were simply a human matter, then Jesus needed to be only a human being. But what if the New Testament speaks about salvation in terms quite other than didactic or political? What if the witness of the New Testament and the life and practice of the Church from the beginning regarded salvation as something far more than the adjustment of thought or of social structures? Salvation is not a human accomplishment. In the words of Fleming Rutledge, the human heart needs to be changed from the bottom up, but it cannot be changed by our natural strength and good works. It can be changed only by the intervening presence of the living God. In May 2018, Pope Francis issued an apostolic exhortation on the call to holiness in today's world. Its Latin title is Gaudete et Exultate, or Rejoice and Be Glad in English. In Chapter 2, the Pope mentions two false forms of holiness that can lead us astray: Gnosticism and Pelagianism. These are two heresies from early Christian times, yet they continue to plague us. Let's consider the second of these, Pelagianism. It takes its name from Pelagius, a British theologian of the 4th and 5th centuries. Don't confuse Pelagianism with plagiarism, which is copying the ideas of another person and passing it off as my own without acknowledgement. The Catholic Catechism summarizes the teaching of Pelagius in these words: Pelagius held that human beings could, by the natural power of free will and without the necessary help of God's grace, lead a morally good life. His most notable opponent was St. Augustine, the Bishop of Hippo. Fleming Rutledge again. I love the writings of St. Augustine. He is still so modern. When he was arguing with Pelagius, he made fun of what Pelagius had written. Pelagius wrote that we need God in order to help us more easily to resist the evil spirit. Augustine says, I'm paraphrasing, what's with this more easily? Why not just say simply, we need the help of God to overcome evil? What does that more easily add? It adds human potential. We can beat evil on our own, Pelagius would have us think. But we appreciate God's help so we can do it more easily. Jesus, our Saviour, is about to do what we ourselves are powerless to do. He is going to prepare a place for us. In my Father's house, there are many places to live in. Otherwise, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? And after I have gone and prepared you a place, I shall return to take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. In John's Gospel, the Passover lambs are being slain in the temple at the very same time that Jesus, the true Passover lamb, is dying on a cross just outside the walls of Jerusalem. It is through his death on the cross that Jesus prepares a dwelling place for his disciples. This dwelling place is eternal life and communion with God. One word that the Greek New Testament uses when it talks about Jesus going ahead of us is prodromos. John's Gospel doesn't use this word, but we do find it in the letter to the Hebrews in chapter 6, verse 20. Prodromos is usually translated by the English word forerunner. It means going in advance, or precursor, or advance guard. In the Roman army, the prodromoi, that's the plural of prodromos, the prodromoi were the reconnaissance troops. They went ahead of the main body of the army to blaze the trail and to ensure that it was safe for the rest of the troops to follow. Or to take another example of how the word prodromos was used in biblical times. The harbour of Alexandria in Egypt was very difficult to approach. When the great corn ships approached the harbour, a little pilot boat was sent out to guide them in. It went before them, and they followed it as it led them along the channel into safe waters. That pilot boat was called the prodromos. It went first to make it safe for others to follow. Tom Wright explains it this way. Imagine an explorer cutting his way deep into the jungle. Nobody has been this way before. There are no paths, no trails, no signs that it's possible to go this way. Yet on he goes, forging his way through impossible terrain until he reaches the goal. Once he's done that, others can follow. Jesus is the prodromos, the one who goes ahead of us to prepare a way before us. That is why Jesus tells his disciples at the beginning of today's gospel, "Do not let your hearts be troubled."